I'm Tracy Sabol. Tonight on EWTN News Nightly, Mayday, Mayday, a massive cargo ship issues a warning moments before it rams into a major bridge in Baltimore, causing it to completely collapse. We bring you the latest on the search and rescue efforts, as well as the wide-reaching impact it could have. Showdown at the Supreme Court. Justices hear the biggest abortion case since the Dobbs decision. We'll have analysis and a report with reaction from outside the court. Struggling to survive. Civilians at Rafah try to recover after Israel's latest missile attack. We have the details. And walking with Jesus. How thousands of the faithful will gather in New Jersey to witness the passion of Christ. These stories and more tonight.
From EWTN, the Global Catholic Network, this is EWTN News Nightly.
Thank you for being with us on the Feast of St. Margaret of Clitheroe. Our top story tonight, a major bridge in Baltimore, Maryland collapsed early this morning after being hit by a cargo ship that had lost power shortly before impact. Construction workers and several vehicles plunged into the Patapsco River as a large section of the Francis Scott Key Bridge crashed into the water. Our Eric Rosales joins us from the scene with the latest.
Well, good evening, Tracy. Yes, Secretary of Transportation Pete Buttigieg, along with the two other Democratic Maryland U.S. senators, paid a visit this afternoon to the crash site, reiterating that this is still a search and rescue operation, one that is a very excruciating day for the families of the missing. Secretary went on and to say that this is no ordinary bridge, that this is a lifeline for many of the industries, not only in Baltimore, but throughout the world, and that he said that this will be rebuilt and rebuilt fast with the help of Congress. Tony, if we can show the folks at home a little bit of the bridge itself, you can see that most of the key bridge is, in fact, in the water. Meanwhile, the search continues not only for the six construction workers, but possibly others who were on the bridge at the time it collapsed.
We are still investigating what happened, but we are quickly gathering details. The preliminary investigation points to an accident. We haven't seen any credible evidence of a terrorist attack.
Our hearts go out to all those who were on the bridge and their loved ones. We pray for them. Our gratitude goes out to the first responders who, as we speak, are out there continuing to conduct search and rescue operations.
We will bring whatever resources that the FBI has to bear. We've already brought our crisis response, our victim services, and just recently, our underwater search evidence recovery teams are on site.
At 1:30 this morning, authorities say the freighter, which was from Singapore, was traveling about 8 knots in low power when it struck a main structure of the bridge, causing it to collapse. Officials say the vessel lost power and it issued an emergency Mayday call shortly before the crash. Maryland's transportation secretary says at least 8 members of a construction crew were on the bridge when it went down. They were repairing potholes and other masonry work. Only 2 so far have been rescued. The cold and murky water is making rescue operations difficult.
Once the warning came up and once notification came up that there was a Mayday, who literally by being able to stop cars from coming over the bridge, these people are heroes.
The Coast Guard is still actively searching at this time. We are using response boat crews from 2 of our local Coast Guard stations, one of our helo crews from an air station in Atlantic City, and also one of our cutter crews.
Taking a closer look at the long-term effect, this is a major thoroughfare for ships, and all vessel traffic in and out of the Port of Baltimore has been suspended until further notice. As for the Key Bridge, the Transportation Authority has closed Interstate 695 in both directions, and cars are being detoured to other highways in and out of Baltimore. Officials say as many as 35,000 people per day use the bridge, which was built in the 1970s and was some 47 years old. It spanned 1.6 miles and had a price tag of more than $60 million when it was built. Officials say once the recovery effort wraps up, demolition and then construction of a new bridge will begin immediately.
We are going to get this done. We are going to make sure that this is not just rebuilt, but that we are going to rebuild in a way that remembers the people who this tragedy has impacted.
This bridge collapse is already having a devastating effect on the auto industry. GM, Toyota, and Volkswagen all use the port of Baltimore extensively, and automakers are now forced to ship their cars to other ports so that they can be able to sell their cars in South American countries and around the world. I do want to share with you a graphic. This shows from the FAA. It's restricted fly zone area near the bridge as the search and rescue operations continue. Emergency crews are using drones, and the Coast Guard is using a variety of airships searching for anyone who still may be in the water. Again, a search and rescue operation is still underway throughout the clock around this, around the hour. Everyone is just hoping and praying for a positive outcome. Tracy?
Yeah, absolutely we are, Eric. Question, could there have been more people on the bridge at the time?
You know, I posed that question to the NTSB, and they actually said that in their investigation, they did know about the six construction workers who were working on the bridge. They were filling potholes and other things when the bridge actually did collapse. They are still missing at this hour, but they say that right now they don't know if there could have been any others. They were able to stop some of the cars before the bridge actually collapsed, but right now their main mission is to search for just victims, and of course, they're all hoping for a positive outcome. Reporting from Baltimore, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Okay, thank you, Eric. Well, President Joe Biden addressed the bridge disaster this afternoon from the White House. He says that he directed his team to move heaven and earth to reopen the port and to rebuild the bridge as soon as humanly possible. He spoke before heading off to North Carolina for a speech on the Affordable Care Act. White House correspondent Owen Jensen continues our team coverage tonight. Owen?
Tracy, President Joe Biden also said he's incredibly grateful for the brave rescuers who immediately rushed to the scene. And he promised the people of Baltimore, we're with you and that we're going to get through this together. And he added the Army Corps of Engineers is on the spot, ready to clear the channel and get those ships moving again.
Speaking from the Roosevelt Room, President Joe Biden offers his condolences to the victims of the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapse.
Our prayers are with everyone involved in this terrible accident and all the families, especially those waiting for the news of their loved one right now.
The collapse is almost sure to create a logistical nightmare for months, if not years, along the East Coast, shutting down ship traffic at the Port of Baltimore and snarling cargo and commuter traffic. The president said the Port of Baltimore is one of the nation's largest shipping hubs, and jobs depend on it.
It's also the top port in America for both imports and exports of automobiles and light trucks. Around 850,000 vehicles go through that port every single year.
Earlier, the president posted this picture on social media in the Oval Office, being briefed on the collapse by senior administration officials.
It's my intention that federal government will pay for the entire cost of reconstructing that bridge, and I expect the Congress to support my effort. This is going to take some time.
Meanwhile, with all ship traffic in and out of the Port of Baltimore suspended until further notice, the Bipartisan Policy Center told us,
when shipments are delayed, I mean, there's definitely a ripple effect throughout the economy. I think it just depends on how long the port is closed.
Last year, the port, a major East Coast hub for shipping, handled a record 52 million tons of foreign cargo worth $80 billion.
When there is a sense of emergency around a bridge collapse or other accident, it gets everybody on the same page pretty quickly. And things can move much more quickly than is typical when everybody is on the same page.
Now, back to the president's remarks from earlier today, a reporter asked whether the company that caused the damage to the bridge should pay for it rather than federal dollars. The president clarified he's not going to wait for that to happen. He wants to get it rebuilt and reopened. The president also plans on traveling to Baltimore as quickly as he can. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
All right, let's bring in Kathy Slega. She is a Republican member of the Maryland State House of Delegates, and her district covers Baltimore County. Kathy, thank you so much for being with us. First, our thoughts and prayers are with everyone in Baltimore right now. Really just an unbelievable event. Is there any new information on this collapse that you can share with us right now?
We are waiting along with everyone else for the recovery, and hoping and praying earnestly that they will find some people and be able to recover live people. But, you know, we're hoping for the best. We know that this catastrophic, I mean, it was surreal when you watch the video of this bridge collapsing, is just going to have a huge impact on the entire Baltimore region. This is a bridge that connects two counties, Baltimore County to Anne Arundel County. It is a major trucking artery and commuting artery. And of course, with the bridge fallen in the middle of the Patapsco River, it's impeding the port traffic. So, you know, first and foremost, we're going to do the rescue and recovery of people. And then we will get to work at removing the debris and hopefully getting that port back open as soon as possible.
Yeah, and Kathy, talk to us a little bit more about that for maybe those that aren't familiar with the area. What type of impact will that have on business nationwide and also locally as well?
Sure. So the Port of Baltimore, it has about 140 total jobs with the people that work directly for the port and ancillary jobs. That bridge was a major trucking thoroughfare. We have to cross over the Patapsco River to get, you know, out of Baltimore County if we're going south. And so we either go through one of two tunnels or across the bridge. You know, trucks with hazardous materials are not permitted to go through the tunnels. So, you know, this is going to be a real hardship. And the port itself, amazing. We're one of the four deep water ports on the East Coast. We have the most, it's called RORO, roll-on, roll-off freight, which is cars and truck farming equipment, things that roll on and roll off of ships. We are the top in the nation. And your report earlier talked about cars possibly being diverted to other ports. But, you know, I will tell you, this is a bipartisan, all hands on deck effort. And, you know, we can look at what happened in Minneapolis back in 2007. They had a tragic bridge collapse, and they actually rebuilt that bridge in less than 14 months. So we know we can do it if we all work together and put aside, you know, any political differences and really work to get this bridge rebuilt.
Yes, so very, very important. Kathy, thank you for your time today. We appreciate it and praying for you all.
Well, thank you so much. This is what our district looks like, the beauty of living on the water and, you know, having that wonderful landmark named after Francis Scott Key, who wrote the Star Spangled Banner. So, you know, we'll look towards more reports as the days go on. And please, everyone pray for the rescue of people that are still being looked for.
Indeed. And we're going to continue to follow this. Thank you so much, Kathy. Now on to our other big story today and what is being called the most significant abortion case since the overturning of Roe versus Wade in FDA and Danco Laboratories versus Alliance for Hippocratic Medicine. The most widely used form of abortion in America is being called into question. Monse Alvarado, president of EWTN News, breaks down the arguments and controversy inside and outside of the courtroom.
We're standing outside of the Supreme Court where both sides have come out in big numbers. For the first time ever, the High Court will be debating one thing, the safety of abortion.
The Supreme Court heard two consolidated cases, both centered around the FDA's approval of mifepristone, the first of two drugs used in a chemical abortion. Elizabeth Prelogar, Solicitor General for the Department of Justice, argued on behalf of the Biden administration. She told the justices that the plaintiffs had no right to seek such far-reaching relief, arguing the doctors and associations are already protected by federal religious freedom laws.
If the doctors have a conscience injury, there's a specific statute designed to deal with it, to specifically tailor-made guard against the risk of that injury occurring. And instead, they're reaching out and seeking to invoke rights under a different statute. And the relief that they're seeking would dramatically alter the approved conditions of use for mifepristone and affect women all around the nation.
The justices seemed unconvinced that the doctors had any right to sue in this case, meaning that access to mifepristone could remain the same.
And this case seems like a prime example of turning what could be a small lawsuit into a nationwide legislative assembly on an FDA rule or any other federal government action.
They're saying because we object to having to be forced to participate in this procedure, we're seeking an order preventing anyone from having access to these drugs at all. And I guess I'm just trying to understand how they could possibly be entitled to that, given the injury that they have alleged.
Questioning the drug maker Danko Labs, Justice Alito attributed financial gain to their defense motives.
I gather your injury is that you think you're going to sell more if the restrictions that previously were in place were lifted.
Yes.
So you're going to make more money.
I think that certainly a company's ability to market its product is a part of how it considers the regulatory scheme that governs its conduct.
Aaron Hawley, senior counsel at Alliance Defending Freedom, represented the pro-life doctors at the high court.
So to speak to Dr. Francis at the beginning, there's been some confusion, I think, about the precise nature of the conscience harm. But if you look at JA 155, paragraph 15, she talks about her and other APLOG members who object not only to taking the life of an unborn child during an elective abortion, but also to, quote, completing that process.
Vastly outnumbering pro-life advocates, pro-abortion groups led arguments of a different nature outside the court.
We're here to support reproductive rights and stand for abortion. If the medicine has been proven to be safe on multiple occasions, why would we not continue to use it?
Dozens of white lab coats could be seen on the pro-life side. Doctors who have helped women who face deadly complications from taking mifepristone. Dr. Susan Bain, a board-certified OBGYN, says she and her medical colleagues are the last line of defense for women who take the abortion pill without medical supervision.
The FDA's label is 1 in 25 women will end up in the emergency department with potentially life-threatening complications. And because of that, we are put in a position to help them. The reality is that what's happening right now with abortion drugs is not standard of care. Women need ongoing care. They need the same medical histories, physical exams, labs, and diagnostic testing. They need follow-up, and they're getting none of that with this.
Montse Alvarado, EWTN News Nightly.
Abortion and access to contraceptives are both expected to be high-stakes issues during the 2024 campaign. Lawmakers on Capitol Hill had their political opinions ready even before the case was argued in the Supreme Court. Most Democrats want ease of access to mifepristone with no limits.
We have to fight for our vision of the future, a future where getting the birth control that you need is as simple and easy as picking up Advil or Tylenol at the pharmacy. No hoops to jump, no questions you have to answer, and no extra cost.
Pro-abortion lawmakers argue that the studies on mifepristone prove that the drug is safe and the scientific judgment of the Food and Drug Administration should be respected. The Biden administration warns that if justices rule in favor of the plaintiffs, the FDA's drug approval process could be undermined and invite more judges to second-guess the agency's decision. The other side of the aisle says things have gone too far.
It is really different in what this administration's doing, where every other administration has talked about safe, legal, and rare. This administration's not talking about safe, and they're not talking about rare. They're just talking about legal.
Pro-life lawmakers contend that a mother's life is put at risk with abortion pills prescribed via telehealth because life-saving screenings are omitted. They also contend that human traffickers can force these drugs on women because an in-person doctor visit is never necessary. Also to come here on EWTN News Nightly, we continue our coverage of the battle over the abortion pill. Next, we speak with a medical doctor who is urging the Supreme Court to block access to chemical abortions. And rain or shine, pro-lifers take to the flooded streets of New York to advocate for the gift of life. Before the break, we heard congressional reaction to today's critical Supreme Court arguments on chemical abortion. But now we turn our attention to the Catholic medical community and its stance on the ethics and safety of using mifepristone. Joining us now is Dr. Gracie Pozzo-Christie, a radiologist who filed an amicus brief on this case on behalf of the Catholic Association Foundation. Dr. Christie, always so good to be with you. So tell us what stuck out to you when you were hearing these oral arguments today.
Well, I was sorry to hear that so much of the case was about standing and that, frankly, the justices didn't seem very convinced by the standing arguments of the plaintiffs. Doctors like me, Catholic doctors, who are very concerned with the safety, with maternal safety. There's nothing we can do at this point about the ubiquity and the widespread use of the chemical abortion drug and the way that it eliminates children. But we can at least work for maternal safety. And it's very difficult to watch all the regulations being stripped away, all the maternal safety safeguards, I should say, being stripped away from the chemical abortion drug. Safeguards that are very important because this is a dangerous drug. It's, you hear people say that it's like Tylenol, and that's simply not true.
Yeah, and I know in your amicus brief, you mentioned the severe health risks caused by the deregulation of these abortion pills. Talk to us a little bit more about that.
So from my point of view, I'm a radiologist, and I do a lot of, every day I do ultrasounds of women, on women and their babies, women who are just in the early parts of their pregnancy when these chemical abortion drugs, you're able to use them with relative safety. However, what I find is that an ultrasound is very important because women don't know how far along they are. They are very often mistaken about that. They don't know the age of their baby. And these chemical abortion drugs get more and more dangerous with every week that passes. So the FDA allows this drug to be used up to 70 days of pregnancy. But in my experience, and this is an experience of many years and lots of patients, women are very often much more pregnant than they think they are. Their babies are older than they think their babies are. So when you take away the physician requirement and the in-person visits, and you allow women and girls to access this drug by speaking to someone on the phone or doing a video consult with someone across the country and then receiving the drugs by mail, you are taking away all these important safeguards for maternal safety, for their lives, for their health, and on so many levels. It's a really terrible thing that the FDA has done, and I think they've done it for political reasons.
Yeah, I know you also focus on the type of emergency room visits that could happen and how they would affect Catholic doctors and hospitals. Can you explain that to us?
Well, because they've taken away the in-person requirement, right? So it used to be that to access this drug, you had to go see, first of all, a physician, not anyone else, but a physician. And the physician had to examine you in person, usually do an ultrasound to see really how pregnant the mother is, and then dispense the drug in person and then have a follow-up visit. So all these contacts with the physician were ways to avoid complications. And if there were complications, to treat for that physician who knows the patient, who knows the process, to treat the complication appropriately. What ends up happening when you have dispensing of the drug over mail, for instance, is women have these unavoidable complications, which are not rare, and they end up in emergency rooms being treated by doctors who don't know the story and who have to step in and sometimes basically participate in an abortion when they are not prepared to do that because they're either Catholics like me or Christians or other people of religious faith, or simply they're just ethical doctors who don't end lives.
Well, so much more we can talk about, but we have to leave it right there. Thank you so much for coming on and speaking to us about all this. We always appreciate it. God bless you.
It's a pleasure for me. Thank you.
A heavy downpours did not stop a joyous pro-life walk from stepping off onto the streets of New York City on Saturday. Organizers say between 350 and 400 people of all ages took part in the Gift of Life walk that weaved through Lower Manhattan. An increased police presence and barricades, however, did not stop pro-abortion protesters from trying to disrupt the event via profanities at pro-life demonstrators, and several of those protesters were arrested. Abortion is legal through all 9 months of pregnancy in New York. Up next on EWTN News Nightly, a New Jersey diocese prepares for its annual reenactment of the Passion of Christ. Welcome Welcome back. Israeli Defense Forces report that they have hit more than 60 terror targets over the last 24 hours. One of the hardest hit areas was in Rafah, where a strike hit a residential building. According to health authorities, at least 16 people were killed. 8 of them were children. The bombardment comes just hours after the United Nations Security Council passed a resolution calling for a ceasefire in Gaza. The U.S. abstained from the vote. The abstention prompted the Israeli prime minister to abruptly cancel the visit of a high-level delegation to Washington this week. Despite that, Israel's minister of defense remained in D.C. for a second day, meeting with defense secretary Lloyd Austin. The two discussed ways to defeat Hamas other than conducting a ground invasion of the southern Gaza city of Rafah. They also discussed the current humanitarian crisis. On new developments tonight, as one of hip-hop's most recognizable stars had his home raided by federal agents. Properties in both Los Angeles and Miami belonging to Sean Diddy Combs were searched as part of federal investigation into alleged sex trafficking. That is according to the Associated Press. In recent months, several sexual assault lawsuits have been filed against the three-time Grammy Award winner, allegations that Combs denies. It is not clear whether the search is related to these claims in the lawsuit. Well, a New York judge has issued a gag order on former President Donald Trump in his hush money case. The order bars him from making public statements about witnesses, prosecutors, court staff, and jurors. Prosecutors asked for the gag order, citing the former president's, quote, long history of making public and inflammatory remarks. The trial is set to begin on April 15th. Well, shares of Donald Trump's social media company soared more than 30% on its first day of trading on the Nasdaq today. Trump Media and Technology Group runs the struggling social media platform Truth Social. The former president holds a nearly 60% ownership stake in the company that had a market value of $6.8 billion before trading began. Investigators could experience a bumpy ride, though. The company has vague prospects of turning a profit, losing $49 million in the first 9 months of last year. The company is traded under the Nasdaq symbol of DJT. While reenacting the Passion of Jesus in Paterson, New Jersey, the faithful will take part in a live dramatization of the Stations of the Cross on Good Friday. Thousands are expected to attend the event that will make its way through the city streets. The reenactment offers the faithful and bystanders a look at the suffering that Jesus endured. It's also a beautiful way to engage younger Catholics in their faith. And we thank you for watching tonight. Remember, you can follow us on social media, Facebook, X, and Instagram at EWTN News Nightly. I'm Tracy Sabol. Good night, and God bless.